When it comes to G-Shocks, one of the biggest questions I've had is why are they so universally loved? Generally, they're on the larger side and always use a quartz movement, which are two things a lot of people are passionately against. Yet with a G-Shock, it's not only accepted, but often embraced. Now, never having owned one, this was always a big mystery for me. And one of the reasons I decided to finally venture into G-Shock territory and get one was to try and find out what makes them so special. So I started out by narrowing down which G-Shocks I was interested in, and I actually presented that to all of you last month. Your comments were very useful, and it really gave me an idea of what I was getting into. And eventually I did make the decision to go with the blue square GW-B5600. Yet right before I ordered it, I got an email from John, who's a subscriber, and he offered to sell me his like new GSTB-200. Which was another one I was really interested in. Now, since he gave me such a great price on it, I decided to go ahead and get that blue square as well. So I kind of went from no G-Shocks to two G-Shocks rather quickly. And I actually have a third that's on the way. So you could say they're a bit addicting. Now, eventually I'll get to that GSTB-200, but today we're going to take a look at the square. And the main reason for that is that Dave over at Just the Watch also recently got a square. Although his is a bit more colorful. But we talked about it and decided to try another dual premiere. So if you haven't already, go check out Dave's video after this. But right now, let's dive into the GW-B5600. Often imitated, but never quite duplicated, the square is the original G-Shock design. It's digital and one of the smallest available. I believe that all the squares are about the same size. And specifically here with the GW-B5600, we're looking at a watch that's 43.75mm wide and has a 48mm lug-to-lug, with a total thickness of 13.4. And one thing I've learned with G-Shocks is that if you're comparing this to a traditional watch, you need to look at the width with the crown, not without. So with that in mind, I don't think a watch with a total width of 44mm is that bad, and I think most people could easily wear a square. Which right there is key to understanding it, as it's supposed to be a great everyday watch, and that's really the main reason I went with one. In a lot of ways, it's really designed to be the ultimate everyday tool watch, with just a focus on functionality and much less on fashion. It's tough, durable, yet feature-rich, all in a small compact package. Now, another thing I learned about the G-Shocks is that lug-to-lug on a lot of them can be a little bit deceiving. And a lot of that is because of the molded straps they use. The first few sections of those straps don't really bend down, so you kind of have a longer effective lug-to-lug than you would normally expect. It's not a lot, and overall the straps are still very comfortable to wear. They're extremely tough and durable, but as the heat is starting to rise here in Texas, I have noticed that they're not the most breathable, and after a full day of wearing it, it did start to feel a little bit sweaty and restrictive. So I was curious enough to try out a few of the strap adapters, which I'll have some links down below, but I don't really want to go into too much detail just for the sake of time. But I still wanted to mention it because you are going to see a variety of straps on the square. Now, one of the adapters is from Ritchie and just acts as a pass-through for most Natos. While the other is from J&K's off eBay and lets you use two-piece straps. And between those two, I was able to try this on a whole variety of straps. Now, while most of the straps I used were more comfortable than the stock one, they never looked quite right. There was always something just a little bit off about it compared to the stock strap, and some that just looked flat out wrong. Although with the GST-B200, that's a whole other story. Now, I should point out that there are a few versions here that come with a cool polymer bracelet. Yet, I didn't go that route because I really like the blue on this one. And I was already planning on picking up one of those metal case and bracelet mods off AliExpress, which I was hoping would be here, but right now it seems to be stuck in shipping purgatory. Anyway, let's move on to the watch itself. And I've always thought the squares looked rather cool. It's a bit of a stealthy look, with a case shape defined by a mixture of smooth curves and jagged angles. Considering these have been around since the 80s, I'd say the design is a bit retro-futuristic. And I really love the blue highlights on this one, especially since it replaces the usual, unusual brick design. Now, the GW-B5600 runs about $140, which is a little bit more than some of the other squares. Yet it has most of the features you could want, and I think it has the same capabilities as the full metal G-Shocks, which are a bit more. Now, with it, you got your standard clock, world time, alarm, stopwatch, and timer. Pretty much everything you could use on a normal daily basis. And this one also has multiband, so if you do live in an area where the atomic time is broadcasted, it should automatically update itself. As well as tough solar, so as long as it's getting some light, it should always be good to go. Now, the GW-B5600 also has Bluetooth connectivity, which was one of the things I was really curious about. Overall, I think it's a cool concept, but I didn't find it overly useful. Most of the features it gives you are things I wouldn't use on a monthly basis, let alone weekly. The big thing is that it does open up the ability to sync up with your phone for time, and that can be useful if you're traveling or if you live in an area where you can't pick up the atomic signal. And for world time, it actually lets you specify 5 cities you want to look at, rather than, say, scroll through the entire world, which I found to be a lot more useful than on the GSTB-200, as well as it makes it easier to set alarms and reminders. There were also 2 features that were kind of hit or miss depending on if it would work, such as pressing a button on the watch to have the phone record your position and time, which could be useful on rare occasions, but it only worked about 50% of the time. And the same goes for the phone finder feature, where if you hold the same button long enough, an alarm is supposed to go off on your phone in case you misplace it, and I never quite got that to work on Android. So in retrospect, having these features in the Bluetooth is kind of cool, and if you're traveling it could be useful, but I'm not sure if it's worth a whole lot more than one without it. Now, another thing I was curious about is the negative display. From comments on my original video, some people love it and some people absolutely hate it. And after having it for a bit, I wouldn't quite say I hate it, but I'm definitely not a fan. In certain lighting conditions and angles, it looks great, but most others, it's just kind of faint to make out. Which really made filming this and getting the watch at just the right angle to be able to see the display just a huge pain in the ass. And what I personally found frustrating was that in a lot of conditions where I'd have no problems reading a traditional three-handers, I'd be straining to make it out on the G-Shock. So for me, having the backlight trigger when you rotate your wrist is an absolute must. As with that, it does make it a whole lot easier to read in most situations. And since this is solar, I'm not really concerned about battery life. Now, if you're using that backlight, there is just a small delay, which can be annoying when you just want to know the time. But personally, I still find it much easier to read a digital watch than a three-hander, so I think it about evens out. The finish of the watch is very G-Shock-ish, or at least square G-Shock-ish. Most of what you see and feel are the polymer shroud, which sits over the case and the mineral crystal. It's a nice smooth black plastic, except for the rear, which has a very nice cut metal case back. Overall, just really stealthy and cool looking, if a bit utilitarian. There is one part of the finish I found disappointing, and that's the bottom of the shroud where it meets the case back and has the cutouts for the buttons. It's just that the finish there felt like something I'd expect on a $50 watch, not $150. Which could be true, as I would bet that some of the squares share components, so it could be the same shroud that's on the $50 G-Shock. And as long as I am being nitpicky, I did think that the buttons here were a little hard to press. Not really more than most other digital watches, so I don't think it's a big deal. But I still wanted to mention it because it is different than some of the other G-Shock models like this one that have these massive, jumbo, easy-to-use buttons. Now, I focused on a lot of things I didn't like and things that bother me, mostly because that's kind of my job here, just to give you guys an idea of what to expect. But here, I think the positives far outweigh the negatives. As a whole, it's got a lot of functionality and capability in a small, really comfortable package, which I think is why people love G-Shocks, and especially the squares, as they are purposefully built and designed from the ground up to be the ultimate tool watch, to be rough, tough, and full of features to help fulfill a specific role. It's a watch that doesn't need to be babied or worried about no matter what you're doing. And I think people are willing to embrace even the larger versions just because of that, as they see the various design choices here to be necessary to fulfill a specific role. Even the humble square, which I see as a multi-purpose everyday watch, is really built to take whatever punishment you can give it, and still hold its own in the water with 200 meters of resistance. It really is one of the best grab-and-go quartz watches out there, and if you get one with solar and multi-band, it's always accurate and always ready to go when you are. So if you're looking for a great everyday digital watch, or maybe just a beater that can take a lot of punishment, then you should definitely be looking at the Gshock squares. Although, unless you think you'd actually use the Bluetooth features, I'd suggest you look at the GW-B5600 for $50, or the GW-M5610s, which add multiband and solar, for about $100. And when shipping eventually gets back to normal, you could always order one of those metal case mods and get a full metal Gshock for a lot less. Now, as usual, let me know down below what you think about this watch, or any of the squares that are out there. And if you haven't already, go check out Dave's video on his Gshock, as it kind of has a style of its own. And as always, if you enjoyed the video, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Thanks for joining me.